Sarvebhyo Namaha. On behalf of Vivekananda Study Circle, I extend a warm welcome to the guest Swami Sarvapriyananda ji, professors, students, residents of the campus, Swamijis and Brahmacharis from the Ramakrishna Math to our special lecture, Beyond the Known and the Unknown, the Wisdom of the Keno Upanishad. Now I request Bharadwaj and Satish to start the program with an invocation. I request everyone to stand up for the invocation.
सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः असतो मा सद्गमय तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमय मृत्योर्मा अमृतंगमय तेजोऽसि तेजोमयि देहि वीर्यमसि वीर्यमयि देहि बलमसि बलमयि देहि ओजोऽसि ओजोमयि देहि मन्युरसि मन्युमयि देहि सहोऽसि सहोमयि देहि.
I request the guest of the evening, Swami Sarvapriyananda ji, the faculty advisor of VSC, Professor C. Balaji, and spiritual mentor of VSC, Swami Atmashraddhananda ji, to offer flowers to Swami Vivekananda. I request Swami Sarvapriyananda ji to kindly grace the dais. I request our volunteer Satish to present a fruit basket to Swami Sarvapriyananda ji. Swami Sarvapriyananda ji is a renowned monk of the Ramakrishna Math and Mission. After having had a degree in business management from Xavier Institute of Management, Bhubaneswar, he joined the Ramakrishna Order in 1994. He has been serving the Ramakrishna Math and Mission for over 20 years now in various capacities, including Vice Principal of Deoghar Vidyapith Higher Secondary School, Principal of the Sikshana Mandira Teachers Training College at Belur Math, and the first Registrar of the Ramakrishna Mission Vivekananda University at Belur Math. At present, he is an Acharya at the Monastic Probationer Training Center at Belur Math. Recently, he has been ordained Assistant Minister, Vivekananda Society of Southern California, Los Angeles, USA. Swamiji has been a speaker at TEDx IIM Ranchi. Besides premier Indian institutes like the IITs and IISc, he has also delivered lectures on Vedanta extensively across the USA and Australia, New Zealand, including noted universities such as the University of Queensland, University of Sydney, University of Adelaide, Victoria University, and University of North Texas, etc. His interest lies in the fields of Indian and Western philosophy, spirituality, psychology, management sciences, and education. It is not an overstatement to say that Swami Sarvapriyananda ji is a tidal wave created in the ocean of Vedanta. Having said these few sentences about him, without any further delay, I welcome Swami Sarvapriyananda ji to deliver the talk.
ॐ नमः श्रीयतिराजाय विवेकानन्दसूरये सच्चित्सुखस्वरूपाय स्वामिने तापः. Revered monks and dear brahmacharis, members of the faculty and students, it's a great pleasure to be back here at IIT Madras. I was here some time back giving talks on Vedanta. So today's subject is what one would call hardcore Vedanta. And I can see I have a very interested audience here. So without any further delay, let's get started. Let's dive straight into the ocean of Vedanta. What is Vedanta? The traditional definition is Vedanta Nama Upanishad Pramanam. Vedanta is the knowledge which we get from the texts known as Upanishads. And what do these Upanishads tell us? They tell us we are fundamentally mistaken about who we think we are. We think we are these limited creatures, body and mind. And Vedanta tells us that we are something else entirely. And not only that, Vedanta also promises, it claims that once we know the truth about ourselves, we will be able to transcend human sorrow and limitation and attain bliss, joy. It's a big claim, and it requires deep study of the Upanishads and thinking about it and meditation upon these truths in the Upanishads to get a first-hand experience and an intrinsic and intuitive awareness of this truth which the Upanishads claim to proclaim. Let's go straight into the Keno Upanishad. Among all the Upanishads, one of the smaller ones, and I have picked this Upanishad for a particular reason. You see, most of you who have studied any amount of Vedanta will immediately be aware that what Vedanta tells us about ourselves is that we are pure consciousness, we are existence, consciousness, bliss. We are not limited beings, mortal beings of flesh and blood. This is what the Upanishads tell us. This is what Vedanta claims to tell us. And in fact, if you go to any standard text on Indian philosophy, you open the chapter on Advaita Vedanta, that's what you'll find. Vedanta says that we are Satchidananda. This Satchidananda, existence, consciousness, bliss is the only reality. It appears as the world. And our true nature, you or I, we are really Satchid Ananda. Brahma Satyam, Jagat Mithya, Jiva Brahmevanapara. This is the central truth of Advaita Vedanta. Now, there's a problem with this. The problem is, will become clear as we go on. And this is where the Keno Upanishad in particular is very useful. And it's very interesting also. It uses a special technique, the technique of paradoxical language. When we read the Keno Upanishad, as we shall do now, extracts from it the most important parts of the Keno Upanishad, we will find the language is mystifying. It's a very strange language. So our purpose today will be twofold. One, which I can sort of guarantee that if you listen carefully, the purpose will be served, that if we study it carefully, we'll be able to understand that paradoxical language. We'll be able to understand, at least intellectually grasp, appreciate what the Keno Upanishad is telling us and also why it uses that paradoxical language. And the second objective, which is after all the goal of all this, is to have an intuitive feel for this. If we get that, then we are blessed. And let's hope at least some of us will get a glimpse of that. If not today, this evening, at least in our lives, sometime we'll get a glimpse of that. Okay, we have a special effect here. Here is the first verse of the Keno Upanishad. It's set in the form of a dialogue between teacher and student. The names of the teacher and student are not given, but you can see questions and answers. And the first question which starts off the whole Kena Upanishad, in fact the first word itself is Kena, you can see that. That's how the Upanishad gets its name, Kena Upanishad. And it's a question by a very sophisticated student. The question itself, I will explain what's the question and why is it sophisticated. And then we'll see how the teacher responds to that. The question goes like this. Kene shetam patati preshitam mana. Kena prana prathama prayeti yukta, kene shitam vacham imam vadanti, chakshu shrotram kaudeva yunakti. What does it mean? Impelled by what does my mind think about objects? I'm always thinking, right now you are thinking, I'm also thinking. We think consciously or we think by automatic habit, but we are thinking. Impelled by what does my mind think? Impelled by what, controlled by what, instigated by what does my prana, the vital forces within me, they perform their various actions. Keneshitam vacham imam vadanti. I speak, vacham, I speak. Impelled by what? Instigated by what do these words come out from me? And finally, chakshu shrotram kaudeva yunakti. Eyes, ears. We have an experience of seeing. Right now you're seeing. You have the experience of hearing. Right now you're all hearing. What is that within me which makes me hear, which gives me this experience of hearing? Basically, our entire conscious experience, our entire experience of our life, we hear, we see, we smell, we taste, we think, we remember, we feel, we breathe. This entire conscious experience, what makes it possible? Now this question is interesting. The answer, of course, I mean, I will not keep you in any tension, the answer will be consciousness. But here is the interesting thing about it. That consciousness makes all this possible, seeing, hearing, thinking and feeling and all that. But you know, if you investigate a little deeper, the question and the answer both are not as simple as they seem to be. For example, seeing. Nowadays you have sensors. Even a robot can see in after a certain fashion. Speaking. I'm sure even this simple laptop can also, will also, if you run a voice program, voice synthesizer program, can actually speak in a certain way. It can produce sounds and can produce, it can produce speech. So that's not what is mentioned. That's not what is intended here. What is intended here is not so much the process of speaking or seeing or hearing, rather, the conscious experience which we have when we see or we hear or think or speak. Let me explain further what I mean. There is a certain something, you know, like what is it like to see such a, see something? You know, you see a red flower. When you see a red flower, I am sure there are certain neurons firing in your brain. The light goes from the flower to your eyes and it is the impulses are conducted to your brain. And certain neurons will be firing in your brain. And all of that is objective. It's biological, it's objective. It can, at least in principle, be observed by an external observer. In fact, even the firings in the neurons in your brain can be observed if you, nowadays they have this fMRI. You hook it up and you can see that happening. All of that is objective. It is observable by the external observer. But the interesting fact is, inside you, inside any of us, when we are seeing something, quite apart from the mechanism of seeing, starting from the light coming to my eyes and being transmitted, the impulses being transmitted to my brain and the neurons firing this way and that way, whatever, quite apart from that, our experience of seeing is a first person experience, how it appears to me or to you inside. It's a subjective experience. And neuroscientists, philosophers, they have a term for this, they call it qualia. They call it qualia. This, those who are doing research in neuroscience, you know this term. This is called the hard problem, within quotes, hard problem of consciousness. There's an easy problem of consciousness and a hard problem. The so-called easy problems of consciousness are those which, you know, for example, what happens when you see something, when you hear something, when you remember something, what part of the brain becomes active when you are remembering. These things are easy in the sense that these are observable from by an external observer with the appropriate instruments. But the inner experience of seeing, how it feels to you, for example, when you feel hungry and there's a certain feeling of hunger, which all of us, we know, we feel hungry. Now, externally, a physician or a doctor or a scientist can collect enzymes and secretions from your stomach, can even map the firings of neurons in your brain and say that this person is hungry. Now, you can see there are two sides of this. One is an objective side, which a scientist can observe. One is the subjective side, which is available privately only to the individual who is experiencing it. Do you see the remarkable nature of consciousness? There is no other entity in this universe which has these two aspects. I'm saying a very big thing here. Everything else has only one aspect. This mic or this table, there is no such thing as what it is like to be a table. It's just a table which we can see from outside and we can observe. But in conscious events, like seeing something, there is something that you can observe as a scientist and then as an external observer, and there is something from inside how it feels to see something. Do you see the dual nature of consciousness? There are two aspects of it. So here, what the student is asking is a pretty sophisticated question. He is not asking, how do I think? He's not asking about the processes going on in the brain. He's not asking that question. How do I see? What makes me see? He's not asking about lights and lens in the eyes and the nerves linking it to the brain and neurons which fire when we have a visual cognition. None of that. He's not asking that. He's asking what produces that first person experience, or in modern terms, what produces that qualia, that subjective experience which I have of thinking, of hearing, of seeing. And this is very important, because you see, our entire universe, as conscious beings, is composed of these qualia. It is these subjective experiences which we are having all the time. That's our actually our life. That's our life. We think, we remember, we feel, we see, we hear, we smell, we talk, we act, and all of these are conscious experiences which we are continuously having. And this is the question. There's a second aspect to this question. Not only what produces these conscious experiences, he is quite sure that the body and the mind cannot do it. Which is a big step, because so far the way we proceed in science is that we are sure that the brain is in some way producing consciousness. Till now we don't know how. We don't know how, but we know the brain and consciousness are linked. Brain and the mind are linked. But how exactly does it interact? How does it produce consciousness? We don't know. Here, the questioner seems to be assuming or taking for granted that this cannot happen. Consciousness is not a product of the body-mind system. It's not that the body is producing consciousness or my brain is producing the mind. Something else is there. It's just like, the question is like this. Here is this mic or this light. You know, this mic, microphone, when it came in a box from the shop, it did not amplify, it did not produce, it did not take sound and, you know, start amplifying it in the hall. Something else has happened when you hooked it up to the electricity. The same microphone suddenly starts taking my voice and taking it to you. The same projector, when it came in a box, it did not project pictures. So when you hooked it up to the electricity, and suddenly, you know, it starts doing that. All the instruments, all the capacity for doing what it does is in that projector. But it requires something else from outside. So when you see the projector sitting in a box, and the projector sitting on the table and projecting a picture, you are entitled to ask, what happened to it? What entered into it which is making it do this? Electricity is there. There is a fan and a bulb. By itself, the fan does not rotate. The bulb does not shine. Suddenly it starts shining and you are entitled to ask, what entered into the bulb or the fan which makes the bulb shine and the fan go round and round? In the same way, he is asking, what happened to this inert body which makes it feel conscious, which makes it able for me to, you know, hear and think and see and act? So there is something external which has come into this body-mind system. That's what he seems to be asking. Even the mind, modern science has still not come to grasp the mind, you know, whether it is just an epiphenomenon produced by the brain or is it something else, we don't know. But in Vedanta, body and mind are regarded, both regarded as matter. Even the mind is regarded as matter. How is the mind matter? Well, it's pretty obvious actually. For example, people who have psychiatric problems. So the doctors prescribe medicine for them. And the medicine obviously acts on the body, but you can see it acts on the mind also. The person is cured. You do not go so far. Take a cup of coffee and suddenly you feel alert, you feel talkative. So the mind is being influenced by something that you ingest into the body, by matter. So the mind also must be in some way matter. This matter and consciousness, they seem to be two different things. This consciousness which produces the first person experience and matter which is the object of these first person experiences, they seem to be two different things. And how is it that consciousness seems to be in this body and mind and we are having all these experiences? That's what the question is. By what does my mind think, go out to objects? By what does the vital forces in the body, what do they perform their functions? But impelled by what do I speak? I have that experience of speaking. Impelled by what do I have the experience of hearing or seeing? This is the question. And the answer, here's the disciple who's asking, and the answer will of course be consciousness, but here is an answer given by the teacher, and here is the speciality of the Keno Upanishad. What does the teacher say? The student says, by what bright thing, you know, he says, Deva. Deva literally means a luminous being. By what luminous entity does the, blessed by that, the body and the mind, they become aware. We have these first person experiences. And the teacher says, that Deva you are asking about, that Deva you are asking about is consciousness, but that is not the language which the teacher uses. And this is what we will concentrate upon this evening. This interesting language used in the Keno Upanishad and how it helps us to actually directly appreciate the Atman or the self within. The teacher replies in paradoxical language. Shrotrasya shrotram manaso mano yat vachoha vacham sa upranasya pranaha chakshushas chakshur atimuchya dhira pretyasmad lokad amrita bhavanti. The answer is very interesting. Instead of saying, it is consciousness. What you are asking about, O Sishya, is consciousness. Instead of saying that, the teacher says, you want to know what makes the ears hear? What makes the eyes see? Well, it is the ear of the ear. It is the eye of the eye. Shrotrasya shrotram. What makes the mind think? It is the mind of the mind. Manaso mana. What makes the speech speak? Vachoha vacham. The speech of the speech, and the prana of the prana, the life forces of the life forces, and chakshushas chakshu, the eye of the eye. Knowing this entity, which is the eye of the eye, the ear of the ear, the mind of the mind, and the life of the of life, knowing this entity, atimuchya dhiraha, one, the wise person, transcends the limitations of human life, and pretyasmad lokad amrita bhavanti, transcends this world and becomes immortal, attains to immortality. This is the answer. It's a very interesting answer. Let's investigate this a little deeply. You see, what's happening here is this. If you open any textbook on Advaita Vedanta or Indian philosophy, it will tell us that Advaita teaches us we are not this body, we are not this mind, and there is something called consciousness beyond this body and mind, apart from this body and mind, which we really are. That's what it tells us. Now the problem with this approach is that once you say, I am not the mind, once the teacher tells me I am not the mind, once the teacher tells me I am not this body, I am something called consciousness or Atman, what do? I say, here is the body. And if I close my eyes and feel inside, I can sense my thoughts, my emotions, my perceptions. So that's the mind. And now you are telling me there is something called Atman, pure consciousness. Our tendency is to look for that. Our tendency is to look for one more object, which is consciousness or Atman. It's inbuilt within us. We objectify, we tend to investigate in the world outside or in our body or in our mind and try to find something. So here is the body, here is the mind. You're telling me I'm not the body, not the mind. I am something called Atman. Let me try to find out. When Shankaracharya says, Mano buddhi ahankara chittani naham, I am not the mind, not the buddhi, not the ahankara. Chidananda rupah shivoham, I am consciousness, existence, bliss, shiva swarupa. Very good. Our tendency is, now let me try to find out that. Chidananda rupah shivoham, which is that? Body I understand, mind I understand. This Chidananda rupa shivaha which you are speaking about, let me try to understand that and grasp that. Now that is a big mistake. It can't be done. It's something like, let me tell you this little story which is used often to illustrate the problem and the solution too. There were these 10 friends who started out from a village and they were going to some other place, and on their way they had to cross a river. And when they crossed the river, they came out on the other side, and one of them thought, have we all crossed over or did anybody drown? Let me count. And he started counting. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Oh my God. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. The 10th person has drowned. There are only 9 here. The other person said, no, you're not counting correctly. Let me count. And he also counted 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Where is the 10th person? And they didn't know where the 10th person was. They were, you know, they started crying and they sat down and said, alas, our friend is dead. The 10th person is dead. And there's this wise person who was walking by and he said, why are you all crying? Well, sir, this is the problem. We are 10 and we crossed the river. Now we are only 9. And 10th person has drowned. That's why we are crying. And this gentleman, he quickly counted them mentally and just counted them and saw they were 10. And he said, well, the 10th person is there. Where is the 10th person? Don't worry. And the guru comes and says, Atman is there. Where is this Atman? Just calm down. I'll show you the Atman. I'll show you the 10th person. All right. Please count. I counted, sir. There are only 9. Count again. Just for my sake, just count once more. All right. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And that passerby, the wise passerby, he held his hand and turned it towards himself and said, Dashamastvamasi, you are the 10th. This person was taken back. Just a minute, let me try it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Oh my God, the 10th person is there. I found the 10th person. The other people also joined in. Let me try. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. I am the 10th. Nice story. How does it apply here? You see, the problem is the same. We are counting the body, the prana, the mind, the intellect, subtler and subtler and subtler, and we expect one more thing called the Atma. We expect one more thing called consciousness. We can go up to a thought, a memory, an understanding also. 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. I am Swami Sarvapriyananda. It's a thought. I can go up to that. Beyond that, if I look for one more consciousness, I'll never find it. Because I'm looking for that, that which is looking is that consciousness. The one which is looking, the one which is counting, body, prana, mind, buddhi, that one which is counting, which is illumining all this, that one is consciousness. How will it know itself? How can the knower know itself? Vigyataram mare kena vijaniyat, Vivekananda Upanishad says, how can the knower, by what can the knower know itself? That which is illumining everything, how can that know itself? That is the problem, and that problem is tackled in a very interesting way. You see, you might even say, well, there is a simpler way. Why doesn't the teacher say, it's you yourself? Uh-huh. It is not the body, not the mind, you. The real you, that is this the answer to your question. And like the 10th person, you are the 10th person if you say. Now the problem there will be, if you say, I am the Atman, I am already under the delusion that I am the body and mind. So if you say, I am the Atman, I'll say, this is the Atman then. Or I will say, the mind is the Atman. It's not very easy to dissociate yourself from the mind. Even theoretically, I can say, I can sing with Shankaracharya and say, Mano buddhi hankara chittani naham. Look at the language there too. I am not the mind. I am not the intellect. The intellect which is doing all this discussion, all this understanding which we are trying to do right now, is where? Is in the intellect. That which is doing all this, I am not that also. And even more paradoxically, ahankara naham, that I feeling which I have got, the ego, aham, I am not that also. I am not the I. If you look at the Sanskrit, ahankara naham, I am not I. That which is aware of the I, that which is aware of the I, that which illumines the I, that is my real nature. Then only I can say Chidananda Rupah Shivoham. And here the strategy adopted by the teacher is this. What he says is Shrotrasya Shrotram. He says that which is the ear of the ear. When you say ear of the ear, what does it mean? That which is apart from the ear. Ear of the ear means something apart from the ears, the auditory system, something apart from that, but which enables the ear to hear. The eye of the eye, that which is not the visual system, but which enables, which like electricity comes from outside and enables the projector to project, the mic to amplify, the fan to go around, and the lights to shine. Just like that. If you were to say, it is the mic of the mic, you want to talk about electricity, it's the mic of the mic, it's the projector of the projector, it's the light of the light. In fact, light of the light is another term used in Vedanta. So, it is something apart from the ears which enables the ears to hear. And it can never be heard by the ears. It is something apart from the eyes which enables the eyes to see, but it cannot be seen by the eyes. It's something apart from the mind, even more subtle. Something apart from the mind which enables the mind to think, but it cannot be thought about by the mind. That thing which enables the eyes to see, the ears to hear, the mind to think, even the speech to be spoken, in terms of our neuroscience discussion which we had a little while earlier, that which gives us the conscious experience of seeing, hearing, speaking, thinking, that is consciousness, and that's what you are. You are not the physical system, you are not the sensory system, you are not even the mind. You are that which shines through all of them and enables all of them to function. Electricity is not a part of the projector. It comes, enables the projector to do what it is designed to do. Electricity is not part of the light. It comes and enables the light to do what it is designed to do, and so on. Similarly, consciousness comes, enables the visual system to see and the auditory system to hear and the mind to think. That is what we are. It can never become an object of the eyes. It can never become something that can be heard by the ears. It can never become something that can be thought of by the mind also. Look at the this verse. And then next he says, just by the way, if you know this, what happens? Know this means, how do you know this? You cannot know it as an object because you can't see it, you can't hear it, you can't think about it. But you know it as your very self, as what we are actually. Then the result will be atimuchyadhiraha. We immediately transcend it. Transcend what? Transcend this body, transcend this mind. How do you transcend the body? It's not that you come out of the body. You are there. But no longer do you identify yourself as with the body. No longer do you think, I am this. I am that which is acting through this. You no longer identify yourself with the mind also. We are not the mind. We are that which is shining through the mind and acting and thinking through the mind. But we are independent of the mind, just as the electricity is something independent apart from all these devices. And knowing this, transcending the body-mind system, we are no longer affected by the problems and sufferings and limitations of the body-mind system. See, problems are there in the world, problems are there in relationships, Problems are there in the body, illness and other problems. Problems are there actually ultimately in the mind. In fact, even all the other problems, problems of the world, relationships, work, physical problems, all of those are problems only when understood by the mind, only when thought about with the mind. You see, the proof is that when the mind is not functioning, say in deep sleep, no problems. I say that the sickest person in the intensive care unit of the hospital, maybe in 1 or 2 days he will die. But when that person is sleeping, has no problem at all. Because the mind is not functioning and not able to understand the problems of the body. So, all these problems are in this system. That which illumines this system is apart from it, does not have these problems. In fact, there is this interesting story of a Sethji, you know, who went to the Himalayas and met a Mahatma and said, Mahatma ji, hum bahut dukh mein hai, hum bahut dukhi hai, I am very miserable. And the Mahatma immediately said, are you aware of your misery? Apna dukh ko anubhav karte hai? Do you experience your misery? Of course I experience my misery. That's why I have come. I have come to you because I am miserable. I feel the misery. I am suffering. Then the Mahatma said, agar aap apne dukh ko anubhav karte hain, dukh ko jante hain, to aap dukh ke gyata hua, gyata huye dukh aapka gyaya hua, aap dukh ke drashta huye, dukh is your drishyam. You are, if you know your suffering, then you are the knower of the suffering apart from the suffering. You are the drashta of the suffering, the suffering in your mind is your drishya. You are apart from the mind, that's what he is saying. If you know the suffering, you cannot be the sufferer. If you know the dukkha, you cannot be dukhi. You are the knower of the dukkha in your mind. Now, and it's not the end of the story. This person went and thought about it. If I know something, I must be apart from it. And just like I see this mic and the eyes are apart from the mic, that's why I can see the mic. Similarly, I know the suffering in my mind, I must be apart from that suffering in some sense. When you think like this, one immediate effect is that the mind quietens down. Actually, your suffering lessens. So this person went and thought about it, and he came back and he told the Mahatma, "Ha Mahatma ji, ab main shant hu." Yes, Mahatma ji, or Swami ji, now I am very peaceful. Immediately the Mahatma scolded him. He said, "Aap shant nahi hai. Aap apne shanti ke drashta hai. You are not peaceful. You are the knower of the peace in your mind." And that is a really great teaching, because you know what trap this person had fallen into? It's a very natural trap, that once I appreciate the peace in my mind, I say, oh, I'm so peaceful. The moment I say that, again I'm caught with the mind. And once this person, you know, he goes back from the Himalayas to his job and his family, and again the nature of the mind is to get disturbed. Again it gets disturbed, and so this person will feel, in the Himalayas, I was so peaceful. In the Himalayas and the ashram, I was so nice. And now, when I have come back to my city and my job and all, again I have become disturbed. You must dissociate yourself. You must know yourself as the witness of the suffering in your mind, as the witness of the peace in your mind also. That is real peace. Then you are not disturbed by the ups and downs of the mind. So that's what it means. One transcends it and becomes immortal. Immortal in the sense, this consciousness, when you realize yourself as that consciousness is unchanging. It is not born. It does not die. No deity nastameti samvit esha swayam prabha. This sun of consciousness, Vidyaranya Swami writes, neither rises nor sets. It is ever shining. Let me give you an example. This is a beautiful example I got from a Swami in Uttarakhand, in Haridwar. At night, the earth, our world is illumined by, nowadays of course, you go out to the city, it's illumined by neon lights, but let's say in a very natural way, it's illumined by the moonlight. The moonlight illumines, gives us light at night. So everything that we see is by moonlight. But we know the light that we get from the moon is not, though we call it moonlight, it's not the moon's light. It is the Sun's light, yes. The sun is not seen at night, but it shines upon the moon and the moon reflects that light back to the earth. And that's what we use for, to illumine the world at night. Now, Vedanta claims this is exactly what is happening now. The mind is like the moon, and our body and external world is like this, the earth at night. So, we think we know everything by the mind. But what's happening is, pure consciousness, the sun is a symbol of the Atman or pure consciousness. And pure consciousness is reflected. In fact, Advaita Vedanta in fact says this. The mind acts as a reflector. It gathers the light or the consciousness from the Atman. And it becomes aware of itself, its own thoughts, emotions, feelings. And it becomes aware of the sensory system. And it becomes aware of the world. So, the good thing about this example is, the moon light does not belong to the moon. But it is what illumines the moon itself and illumines the world. And the sun is not seen at night. The real source of the light is not seen at night. In the same way, the real source of our conscious experiences, the Atman, the pure consciousness, is not an object of consciousness. It's nowhere to be seen. You can't see it outside. You can't see it in your body. You can't even see it in the mind. And yet, that is the source of consciousness. The Upanishad goes on, the teacher goes on to say, it is that by which the eyes are seeing, and that which illumines the eyes and by which the eyes see, but the eyes cannot see that. Exactly like it is sunlight by which the moon is illumined and the moon in turn illumines the world, but the sun itself is not seen. Consciousness or Atman is that which illumines the ears and by which the ears function, they hear sounds, but they cannot hear the Atman. Atman is not a sound. And it's just like the sunlight falling on the moon, which illumines the moon, and the moonlight illumines the world, but the sun itself is not seen. So, all the teachings which the guru will now give, this example can beautifully illustrate. The example of the moon at night. You see, it's not wrong to call it moonlight. But the moon's light is not its own because without the sun, the moon would not have light. And for practical purposes, we see the moon as a luminous body. So we see the moon is shining, it reveals itself, and by its light, it reveals the world. But the source is elsewhere. Without the sun, the moon would be dark and the world also would be dark. In the same way, pure consciousness shining through the mind becomes aware of itself and aware of the body and the external world. So this is the idea given in the Kena Upanishad. So it is the Atman, the spirit by whose power the ear hears, the eye sees, the tongue speaks, the mind understands, the life functions. And the teacher says, you cannot objectify it. Na tatra chakshur gacchati na vaag gacchati no manah na vidmo na vijanimo yathaita danushishyat. The teacher says, since you cannot see it, you cannot hear it, you cannot even speak about it, you cannot even think about it, student, you asked me what is that source by which everything is happening, I am afraid I cannot teach it. It cannot be taught. Now, if I had said that earlier, most of you would be thinking, well, you put up such a big poster and Keno beyond the known and the unknown, and if we come to hear this, that it cannot be taught, I can't talk about it, then why such a big lecture? But then, maybe as the student is getting up to go away from the hall, the teacher says, wait a minute, there is a very interesting method which we can use. The method is this. The teacher says, that which you are asking about, the Atman, the true self, anya deva tadviditad aviditad adhi. And this is where this lecture has got its title from. That which is the true self in us is not among what you know, is not known, and it is not unknown also. Now this is a very powerful statement, a paradoxical, paradoxical language of the Keno Upanishad, and he says the true self within, the Atman, is neither the known nor is it unknown. Now just think about it. Our entire universe of knowledge is divided into two parts. One is that which we know. So there are a lot of things that you know, and the boundaries of our knowledge are ever expanding. And we are surrounded by an ocean of the unknown. It's like we have an island of knowledge surrounded by an ocean of ignorance, of unknown. And maybe that which is unknown at one time will become known. We hope we'll know more and more. Now all that we know, all that we can think of, is either known or unknown. If you know it, it's known. If you don't know it, then it falls in the set of the unknown objects. Now what is that? Is there anything you can think of just now which is neither known nor unknown? It's not known to you, and yet it is not unknown. If I ask you this, sometimes I've tried it, and sometimes, you know, little children have given me the answer immediately. It's a very simple answer. And the answer is, think about it, what is that which is not known? You know things, you can see things, you can hear things, you can smell things, taste things, you can remember things, you can think about things. Apart from all this, it's not any of this. Then you say it's unknown. No, it's not unknown also. It's very, I mean, it's absolutely not unknown. I mean, you can even say, what can be more known than that? And it is, yes, it is our own self. It is you yourself. If you think about it, you are not unknown. I mean, after all, what do I know more than myself? So I am not unknown to myself. I cannot say I am unknown to myself. Just like what's there in on the other side of the moon right now, I don't know. In that way, I am not unknown to myself. On the other hand, I am not known to myself also. Because all that I can know is not my true self. I can know the body. I can know the prana moving inside my body. I can sense my thoughts, my feelings. I can remember things. But beyond that, that which is remembering, that which is thinking, that which is seeing, that consciousness they're talking about, that can never become an object of knowledge. I can't know it specifically as this thing. It can never be this. It's always the knower of the this. So, using this kind of paradoxical language, other than the known and other than the unknown, that which is other than the known and other than the unknown. This is what the Keno Upanishad says. And now we can understand why this language is used. If you say specifically, it's you, we immediately make the mistake of identifying ourselves with this physical body, I. So, this is Atman is this. Or more sophisticated way, it's the mind, or is something called consciousness generated by the mind? None of them, because they are in the category of the known, or something that we don't know yet, that's the category of the unknown. Apart from both of them, there is something that knows them. You see, the known and the unknown, they can all be put together under the superset of objects. There are physical objects out there, the subtle objects in our mind. They are objects. The Atman is the pure subject. It does not fall either in the known category or in the unknown category, because all of that is objective. This is the teaching so far. Now is the time, just like IIT, time for a test. So a test not for you, but for the student. And the teacher gives a class test and he says, well, now dear student, I'm going to ask you a question. Let's see how well you have understood what I was teaching. And the teacher says, Yadi manyase suvedeti dabrahmevapi nunam tvam vetha brahmano rupam yadasya tvam yadasya deveshvatanu mimamsyam evate manye viditam. He says, he asks a very unfair question to the student. He says, do you know this Atman? I've taught you about the Atman, the self. So do you know it? Now the student is trapped. If you think about it, what will you say? What will the student say? If you say yes, the student, teacher will say, what have I been telling you all this time? It's not knowable. It's not a known object. If the student says no, it's not unknown. And the student can't remain silent also, because I taught you. You have to say something. either yes or no. And the student is equally brilliant. The student gives an answer fitting to the question, you know. The student says, confidently, says, Manye Viditam, I have known this Atman or Brahman, whatever you call it. Immediately you can see the teacher will get upset. What have I been telling you all this time? You say, you know it. And the student replies, in the language of paradox, as he is giving it back as good as he got. He says, Naham Manye Suvedeti no na Vedeti Vedacha. Yonas tadveda tadveda no na vedeti vedacha. He says, Naham manye suvedeti. At first he said, manye viditam. Yes, I know it. But I am not saying that I know it. Not that I do not know it. I do know it. Naham manye suvedeti. I don't say that I know it. Oh, so you don't know it. And he said, no na vedeti. Not that I do not know it. I do know it, vedacha. And then he turns and says, among all of you, Yonas Tadveda, who has understood what I am saying right now, has understood the Atman. So, you have to understand it as, no na vedeti vedacha, that is something that is beyond the known and the unknown. And that is your own true nature. It cannot be expressed in objective language, and yet we know it very well. Swami Vivekananda, in one of the lectures in Jnana Yoga in London, he talked about this, and then he says, you must not go away with the idea that it is unknown. It is more than known. Your true nature, your true self is more than known. You, that itself shines forth first, then you know everything else. He says, you know that first, the Atman first, then you know the table, or the body, or the mind. So, one who knows it as beyond the known and the unknown has truly understood it. And I'm sure the other students must have been puzzled. What is he talking about? And so the teacher or the Upanishad itself explains. Yasya matam tasya matam, matam yasya na vedasa, avijnatam vijanatam, vijnatam avijanatam. Pure paradox. It literally translates as, the one who does not know it, knows it. One who knows it does not know it. Avijnatam vijanatam. For those who claim to know the Atman, it is not known to them. Vijnatam avijanatam. And it is known very well to those who know that it cannot be known as an object. So we understand that now. Yasyamatam tasyamatam. The one who knows that it cannot be objectified, it is ever the subject, it cannot be seen. It is ever the seer. It cannot be heard. It is ever the one which hears or enables hearing. It's not a thought, but it's ever that which illumines thinking. He knows. Yasya amatam, tasya matam. Because knowing for us means either hearing or seeing or reading or thinking or understanding. And what it says here is that which enables you to hear or see or think or understand, which is always you. Which is always there. You know it. Whether we attend this class or not, whether we ever read Vedanta or not, Vedanta tells us you are that all the time. And all our problems are because we do not know this self. I remember in Uttarakhand we were reading Ashtavakra with one Punjabi Swamiji in Gangotri. Once in a while this old Swami is a very interesting character. He's old and big and fat. And doctor had come to see him, he had ailments. The doctor was very thin. The doctor said to him, Mahatma ji, aap kya khate hain, itna mote ho gaye? What do you eat? You've become so fat. And the Swami immediately replied, he has a wonderful sense of humor. He immediately replied, Doctor sahab, hum chinta ko chaba jate hain, isliye mote ho gaye, aur chinta tumhe chaba jati hai. I eat up all anxieties and worries and I've become fat. And the anxieties and worries are eating you up. That's why you're so sickly and thin. So this Swami would often, sometimes he would close the book and look at us and he would tell us. So in Uttarakhanda style is to address Swamis as Mahatmaji. Mahatmaji, aap jano ya na jano, mano ya na mano, aap hi Ram, tum hi Ram. Whether you accept it or not, whether you know it or not, you are Rama. Rama means God. And this is the idea of God in Vedanta, that pure consciousness shining through each one of us, Shankaracharya says, Yaeva nirakarta tasyaeva atmasa. The one who denies this, that there is no such thing, it is the atma of that very person who is denying its existence. Because of that consciousness, he is able to think and understand, not understand, finally come to the conclusion all this is wrong. And that which is shining through him and enabling him to do all this is the Atman. If you think about it, it's self-proved. In fact, the Advaitin will say every proof depends upon it. All that proof that we do intellectually, whatever we do, try to understand, try to prove it, disprove it, all of that depends on that pure consciousness. Without that, there would be nothing. One Swami in Uttarakhand, he was asked, Ishwar ke astitva mein akatya praman dijiye, give an irrefutable proof of the existence of God. An irrefutable proof of the existence of God. And the answer was immediate. He said, Aapka astitva, your existence. Think about it. We never doubt our existence. You see, there are these two kinds of approaches to spiritual life. I teach the novices, just like them in the training center, I often ask, what do you want in spiritual life? What is your goal in spiritual life? And I get two kinds of answers. One group says, I am searching for God. And there's another group which says, not so much God, I want to know who am I. Search for the self within. And both of these are equally spiritual. You can have a devotional approach directed towards God, search for God, something beyond this universe which is the source of this universe, and something within. Both of them are equally spiritual searches. But there are advantages and disadvantages to both approaches. What is the disadvantage of the God approach? It's obvious. The disadvantage of the God approach is it depends on faith. It starts with belief. Because you don't experience that God, at least not right now. And the advantage of the self-searching approach is nobody disputes that he or she exists. It might be a theoretical problem, but practically nobody thinks that I do not exist. That I believe that I exist, nobody says that. It's ridiculous. So our existence is certain. In fact, the only thing that we are certain about is my own existence. Descartes, the philosopher, when he started doubting everything and finally he said, I think, therefore I exist. My own existence is self-evident, literally. And of course, there are disadvantages with this approach too, because my existence, though it is not open to doubt, but it doesn't do me much good, because my existence is surrounded by so many problems. I suffer, I fall ill, I suffered frustration in life, disappointment, kicks and blows in life are coming to me. So the fact that I exist is no great thing for me. In fact, it might be the source of my problems also. So what Vedanta does, here is the amazing thing. What Vedanta does is, see, the God approach has an advantage. God has no problems. Only thing is whether he exists or not, that is the question. But God has no problem. God is infinitely powerful. Omnipresent, omniscient, all that wonderful things, everything is there with him. Now what Advaita Vedanta does is, this is a remarkable thing, it brings the two together. They mutually cancel out each other's problems and the advantages add up. How it happens is, when Advaita Vedanta says, Tat Tvam Asi, that pure consciousness thou art, which means now you cannot doubt its existence, because that's what I am. I do not doubt my existence. And yet this consciousness does not have the problems of the limited individual body and mind. It transcends the body and mind. So your existence is revealed as an infinite existence. Problem of the individual is we are limited. Advantage, I know that I exist. There's no question of belief. The problem of God is that we have to believe. It's open to doubt and criticism. That's why in every devotional approach, dualistic approach, a lot of effort will be expended in questioning the existence of God and giving arguments for the supporting the existence of God. But the advantage is God is infinite. So the infinitude of God and the certainty of my existence, they are brought together, and my certain, indubitable, infinite existence is revealed in this approach. This is a remarkable approach if you think about it. So that Swami used to say, that's what you are, whether you know it or not, tum jano ya na jano, whether you accept it or not, tum mano ya na mano, tum hi Ram, you are God yourself. And finally, this pure existence, how do I know it? I know that it cannot be objectified, but isn't there any way of knowing it? How, is there any special experience that I can get to know it? You know, the question is like asking, I can see everything that you are sitting here. How do I know? Because I can see it. What is the pramanam, proof that you are here? Because I see it. Look at this question. Something exists before me because I see it. That's my statement. Now, how do I know that my eyes exist? Because the only things that I do not see are my own eyes. I'm repeating the question. I can see all of you. I know you exist here. You are here because I can see you. How do I know that my eyes are here? Let me rephrase that question. By seeing what will I know that I have got eyes? Mirror? Any other answer? Immediate answer is mirror. Any other answer? By seeing what will I know that I have got eyes? By anything, yes, exactly. By seeing others, by seeing anything. In fact, anything that you see is a proof that you have got eyes. Because you are seeing. Indirectly. How do I know the sun exists at night? Because of the moonlight. It is the moon and the light of the moon. But that is a clear proof that there is the sun. Exactly in the same way. How do I know that I have got eyes? By seeing what do I know that I have got eyes? By seeing anything. The moment I see something, it means I have got eyes. In the same way that I am this pure consciousness, what experience reveals to me that I am this pure consciousness? And the answer is, Pratibodha viditam matam amritatvam hi vindate, atmana vindate viryam vidyaya vindate amritam. Pratibodha viditam matam. This phrase itself is one of the most remarkable phrases in the entire Vedantic literature. Every experience reveals to us that we are pure consciousness. Which experience will reveal to me that we are pure consciousness? Every experience. What, by seeing what in the moonlight will you understand that there is a sun? By seeing anything, moonlight itself is a proof that there is sun and sunlight. In the same way, anything that we experience in the world is a conscious experience. Anything that we think is a conscious experience. Forget the objects of experience, what you see, what you hear, what you smell or taste, or the things you think about, but concentrate on the light which illumines it. Let me show it to you practically what I mean. Here, you see,
there is light here, but you can't see it. The moment I put my hand there,
now the problem is, our attention is drawn to the hand.
The teacher wants to draw our attention to the light which is invisible and right here. The light is continuously here. The moment there is an object, something to hear, something to smell, something to see, something to think about also, the light is revealed as a conscious experience. The light is revealed when I put my hand here. The light is not a part of this hand. It's not being produced by the hand. The light is there, here, all the time, whether the hand is there or not. Only thing that happens is, when I have a hand here, you can see the, you can have a vivid experience of not only the hand, but also the light.
Now that's a beautiful example. Whenever we have any conscious experience, our attention normally goes to the object of that experience. When you see this piece of cloth, what do you see? What is your experience? We immediately say it's a piece of cloth. But it's also an experience of consciousness. Isn't it? The eyes are seeing this piece of cloth. So when I see this, the eyes are illumining it. In the same way, any experience through my eyes or nose or ears or in my mind, all of them are being illumined by consciousness, just like that light illumined the hand. What Vedanta tells us is, instead of being aware, instead of focusing on the object of consciousness, the hand, focus on consciousness itself, the light. And the light will be revealed to you by any object that you put in the light. Our consciousness, the true nature, what we are, is revealed by any experience that we have. Pratibodha viditam matam. when you learn to recognize yourself as pure consciousness in every experience, whatever thought comes to your mind, consciousness revealing that thought. I am that consciousness. Whatever you see, consciousness through the mind and eyes revealing that object. I am that consciousness. Whatever sound you hear, it's not only a sound, it's consciousness acting through the mind and the ears revealing that sound. I am that consciousness. The sounds and sights and thoughts and memories come and go. Consciousness is one and unchanging. That is what we are. And that is, he says, that is the goal. To appreciate that we are this consciousness in every, this Atman, this pure consciousness in every experience. Not just in meditation, not just in a Vedanta class, but in every worldly experience also. And that's what, you know, when you say a Jivan Mukta, Brahma Jnani, knows himself to be Brahman all the time. All the time means having all these experiences. For him, all experiences are Brahman experience. Just as any object you put in the light, these are all reflecting the same light. I think I will stop here with a prayer that we have this understanding, this realization in this lifetime. Thank you very much. Thank you. I'll give you two broad methods, two powerful methods. One is, first of all, this Vedantic method. What we studied today, how can we use that to control our mind? What it teaches us is, put very simply, we are not our minds. You are not your mind. Just as you are not this t-shirt, the t-shirt which you are wearing, you are not that. It's something that you have put on. The mind is an instrument. In fact, the term for that in Vedanta is antakarana. Karana means an instrument. So just like you have a pen, just because you have a pen doesn't mean you will always keep writing. Just because we have legs doesn't mean we will always keep walking or running. Only when we want, we use them. In the same way, we must drive it deep into our mind itself that we are not the mind. The mind is an instrument. The mind is an instrument. What are we? We are that pure consciousness which shines upon the mind and through the mind. Once you realize that, there will be a certain separation between yourself and the mind. You see, why do we compulsively think? One reason is, we have identified ourselves so deeply with the mind, its thinking is a proof of our existence. We think we exist when the mind is thinking. If the mind doesn't think, we think we are not there. We feel that somehow. You don't have to use the mind all the time. The mind will think only when you want it to think, and it will think that which you want it to think. I remember when that Himalayan experience I was telling you about, I was once sitting near the Ganga around July, August in Gangotri. And you know, in Gangotri at that time, there is rainfall and there are landslides and there's a lot of water in the Ganga, and it's muddy water, it's flowing very fast. One Swami who stays there, he told me the difference between a yogi's mind and a Vishayi's mind. Vishayi means a worldly person and a yogi person and a yogi, the difference between the minds. And he said, the Ganga, what you see now, and he said, Jade me Ganga, in winter, the Ganga in winter. The Ganga you see now has a lot of water, because just after the rainy season, and it's muddy water. He says, just like that, a Vishayi's mind, a worldly person's mind, a person who has not controlled his or her mind, that person's mind has a lot of thoughts. They say some 16,000 discrete thoughts in a waking day or whatever. So many thoughts, and muddy. That means good thoughts, bad thoughts, unwanted thoughts, all sorts of thoughts. And then he says, this Ganga is dangerous. It's flowing so fast. In fact, the day before, somebody had been swept away and killed. So if you put your foot into it unwarily, you'll be swept away and killed. You'll be drowned. In the same way, a Vishayi person's mind is dangerous. What it will make us do, we don't know. And the proof of that is we regret. Why should I regret doing something which I did it once myself? And then again, one day later or 1 week later or 1 year later, I regret it. Which means I did something that I really don't want to do. Something made me do that. So our minds, when the Vishayi's mind is dangerous, just like that fast flowing Ganga in after rainy season. And he finally said, this water you can't drink because it's muddy and you can't offer it to anybody else to drink also. Similarly, he says, the Vishayi's mind neither gives him happiness nor does it give happiness and peace to people around him. In contrast, he said, Swami, if you come in winter, I will show you the Ganga then. The Ganga then has less water, it's mostly frozen. The yogi's mind has fewer thoughts. These are consciously selected thoughts. And he says, the mind, the water at that time does not flow fast. Sometimes it stops altogether because there is ice, it forms there and the water does not flow. So similarly, yogi's mind is very deliberate thinking, clear and conscious thinking. And if he wants, he can stop it. Samadhi, that's what he wanted to. And he says, it's not at all dangerous. He said, in winter, the water is so less, you can walk across the Ganga. It won't sweep you away. Similarly, the yogi's mind is not dangerous. It's beneficial to him. And finally, he said, Pani itni miti hoti. It's so nice, clear and nice that you can drink it, you can offer it to others to drink. Similarly, a yogi's mind gives him peace and bliss. And those around that yogi, they also feel that radiance of a kind of innate peace, a kind of joy, spontaneous joy they feel in the company of that yogi. And this happens when we, number one, understand that we are not the mind. It's an instrument just like any other instrument. That detachment, it enables us to view the mind impartially, not get upset with the mind. Instrument may be good, may be slightly damaged, may be not so clean right now. Doesn't matter. You are not that. You are not that. So that's the first thing. And the second approach which I talked about was is a yogic approach where you train the mind. Training the mind, one method which we use is using a mantra, for example. Many people use a mantra. So instead of the mind jumping from one thought to another, it's trained to hold on to one thought again and again. You know how the mind works? It's like a lot of trees, a monkey. A monkey goes from one tree to another tree, from branch to branch. And that's how we think. Here is a student, he's wearing a red t-shirt, or red, I saw a red colored car, or the sunset on that beach was red. And see how my mind is jumping from one thought to another thought. And that's how our mind moves. When you do, for yogic practice like a mantra japa, what happens is, it's like you go up a tree and you're not allowed to jump to another tree. You come down the tree again, you go up that same tree again. So the mind is brought back again and again, and it comes under control that way. That's a yogic method. So these are two methods I've told. But dissociation, that means being a witness to your own mind. With the mind, we can be witness to the world. Being a witness to your own mind is a very powerful practice for quietening down the mind. You know, the mind in itself is not bad at all. We disturb the mind. We push a lot of trash into the mind. It's always trained. It's always under pressure. And therefore, it tends to misbehave. Left to itself, the mind is a luminous thing. It's a wonderful instrument. Any other question? So many questions. Okay, we'll start there and we'll go there. What's your name? Parimal.
Does my consciousness control my mind, or my mind control consciousness? Because I am setting some goal for my life.
Yes, true. Now, you have to understand this question carefully. By controlling, we mean just like I'm controlling a laptop. Does the consciousness control the mind in that way? Or does the mind control consciousness in that way? Neither of that is true. It's like, does the electricity control the projector? You see, the electricity enables the projector to do whatever it was supposed to do. Isn't it? In that sense. So consciousness enables my mind and my sensory system and my body to do whatever the mind and body are supposed to do. And you are consciousness. You shine through the mind. So without your blessings, without consciousness, mind cannot function. But if, and depending on the mind itself, if the mind is full of negative thoughts, full of desires, that very consciousness will enable the mind to work out its own doom. So you have to then use the consciousness or the consciousness itself illumining the mind. The mind has to be trained and purified. Then only the mind will be able to attain its goal or the goal of our lives, that is to know ourselves as this pure consciousness. So both are there. Consciousness is enabling the mind to do what it is doing, and the mind also must realize itself, its true nature as the pure consciousness, by training and clarifying itself. So there's a process of purification and a process of spiritual training like meditation, which is necessary. So both are true. To give you a simple answer, it's just like the projector and the electricity in it. You can say in one sense the projector is using the electricity for its own purpose, but on the other hand you can say that without the electricity projector is helpless. Yeah. And also one more thing, what I've told you is not the final conclusion of Advaita Vedanta. You see, here what we have done is isolate consciousness from the body-mind system. That's what they are talking about. Some pure consciousness functioning through the body-mind system. But what Advaita Vedanta finally intends to tell us is, this pure consciousness alone is the reality. The entire body-mind system and the entire universe is imagined, kalpita, in consciousness. It's just like light and all sorts of images which are produced in light. It's not that there is something outside which light shines upon. That's a preliminary step only. And that which is outside is finally realized as something not different from that light. So only consciousness exists in the final analysis in Advaita Vedanta. This is a good question. Basically, you want me to clarify these two ways. What does it mean? One way, the Vedantic way, is a vichara, of understanding ourselves as pure consciousness shining upon the body, mind and external universe. So this understanding is very important. And that understanding happens in the buddhi only. So that understanding enables us to see ourselves as apart from the mind, and that itself helps us to control the mind. That's one method. It's a method of vichara, of separating ourselves from the mind seeing ourselves as separate from the mind and body. That's one method. The other method, the one which you talked about, being lost in an assignment, that's the second method. That's a yogic method where you concentrate, where you focus so much that everything else is cut out. You see, one of the characteristics of our mind is that it has limited cognitive capacity. You cannot be aware of too many things at the same time. So what is concentration? Using our limited cognitive capacity, if you focus it on one thing, the 80 to 90% of our cognitive capacity, that's called concentration. And this cognitive capacity, if you scatter it among many things, you say my mind is distracted. So concentration is basically our focusing our cognitive capacity on one object. So that person is focusing completely on the assignment. And everything else drops out of his field of awareness. So that's one method of concentration. That's called the yogic method of concentration. In fact, in positive psychology, they are working on this. They call it flow. Mihai Csikszentmihalyi is working on that. And the method of concentration, they say that it's a function of challenge and skill. Why is that student lost completely in that assignment? Because of two reasons. One is the assignment is challenging. It's interesting. It's absorbing. Number one. Number two, he has the skills to tackle it. Only thing is, he has to exert himself to the utmost to tackle that assignment. So the challenge is high, the skills are also high, they're equal. If the challenge is too much and the skills are less than that, there won't be concentration, there'll be anxiety. There'll be anxiety, irritation, tension. If the skills are very high and the challenge is much lower, so some problem which you did in class 11 or 12 in maths, now it's easy for you. If that problem is given to you, your skills are much higher than the challenge. The result is boredom. So what happens is only a part of your cognitive capacity is given, the rest is scattered. So you don't feel absorbed or concentrated. Absorption, concentration comes when there is a match. Your skills are challenged to the utmost. Not beyond that, not less than that. That's when we feel that flow or concentration. When you are playing a game, you are absorbed automatically, because every time you are you're playing badminton, if you falter in your concentration, you will lose because the opponent is continuously returning your serve or whatever you're doing. So your focus is always there. when you are driving. If you are driving in a busy road, you are always focused because your skills are being continually challenged. If you are driving in a straight and empty road, sometimes drivers have an accident because their concentration falters because there is no challenge. It's open, it's empty, nothing is coming from in the field of the visual stimuli. So it does not engage concentration and they lose concentration there. Challenge and skill together help us to get concentration. And that's what we should apply in our lives. Especially the student community here, because you are required to concentrate often. If you cannot concentrate, see what is happening in these two dimensions. Is it a problem of too much challenge and less skill? Then break down the challenge into manageable chunks. Is it a question of your skills are far more than what is necessary to do this? Then make the job more challenging. Make it more interesting. Maybe you reduce the time frame. What you are supposed to do in 3 hours, try to finish in 1 hour. Maybe. I mean, you just have to think in your particular case, how can I increase the challenge there? I know one person in a class, and the subject was very easy and the teacher was dealing with material which were known to all of us. And I saw this other brahmachari was very brilliant, one of the most brilliant persons I've seen. He's taking notes furiously. I said, what are you doing? I mean, I was a little surprised. I thought he knows it much better than I do, but he's still so absorbed in it. I saw what he was doing is, he's taking what the teacher is saying, translating into Sanskrit and writing down notes in Sanskrit. He has made it 10 times more challenging, and that's how he's absorbed, whereas I'm just bored. Okay, so challenge and skill, that leads to concentration. That's the second type of concentration. The second type of controlling the mind. Other type is to be aware of yourself as apart from the mind. Yeah, there's a question there.
Pranams Maharaj. Actually, I have two questions. First is, when you showed us that light coming out from projector.
Yes.
And even now it is coming out, but we are not able to see.
We are not able to see it,
yes. I tried to just think of that light. But the thing is, when you see something else is illumined by light,
yes,
we are not able to understand the nature of light. Yes. Only the illumination thing we are able to see.
Yes.
How is the light, whether it's a fire, whether it's something else, we don't know, or the color, at least the color is visible, but
yes,
other things we don't know.
Yes.
Same thing is like our day-to-day experience, when you are saying the consciousness. For example, we are hearing something or seeing something, so it is illumined by consciousness.
Correct.
But we maybe after so much of Vedanta lecture, like hearing this thing, we know that it is Atman, that is like
illuminating
all this thing, but the thing is, we won't visualize, means we won't be able to know the nature of it, how it is. So only when we are in front of that light, then only we know how is that light. So I think only meditation is the way. So, but for our case, we won't be able to do that way, like to have the proper grasp of what Atman is. So we see something, we feel it, but again we forget it because
yes,
we don't know the nature. So how is the way out?
Right.
And second question is also there, little funny thing is, you said suppose we have a box, we got some projector or microphone, and when we hook it, and then it is working.
Yes.
So I found like there is the wave of consciousness, and we all taking up like electricity, we are also being fed by that consciousness, so we are having this life. So but when somebody is dead, is it not possible to hook somehow to that consciousness? So that was going on in my mind.
Okay, I'll deal with these two questions. What happens
then
at death? Yes. First of all, the question of meditation. You see, unless you have a clear idea of what the Atman is, at least intellectually, what will you meditate upon? What will you meditate upon? The technique shown here, this Pratibodhaveditammatam, this one, who intuits it through every modification of the mind. You see, when things keep coming before the light, you put your hand before the light and I ask you what is it, everybody will immediately say it's a hand. But if you think more carefully, what you are seeing is light reflected of the hand. In the same way, every thought that I have, the technique is given here, every thought that I have, a good thought, a bad thought, a memory, a feeling, an emotion, whatever, all of that, these are all different from each other, but all of them are shining in the light of consciousness. And this is what Vedanta says you try to be aware of. As we do this, you will find, first of all, there will be a distance between you, the consciousness, and the thoughts. Second, a kind of peace will come over you. A kind of peace will come over you that I am the constant consciousness illumining the various thoughts, feelings, emotions which come and go. I am the constant consciousness which when the body falls asleep, the mind dreams, I am the same consciousness illumining my dreams. In deep sleep, body is asleep, mind is not working, it seems to be a blank, it is just like the light there now. It seems to be there is no light. It seems to be that there is no consciousness also. It's just that there is no object of consciousness. There is no thought. Therefore, I feel that it was blank. But that blankness itself was illumined by consciousness. And I am that continuous, unchanging consciousness. Now, this is the method, and admittedly, it's a difficult method. It's a difficult method. Why is it difficult? Because of a tendency to chase objects. We keep moving, slipping away from consciousness into the object. That which is illumined by consciousness, our attention is always drawn to that. So a good thought makes me happy, a miserable thought makes me unhappy. And I'm moved by happiness, unhappiness, I forget that I am the consciousness shining upon the good thought, shining upon the unwanted thought, that I forget. So that's the problem with it. And the solution is meditation. In Patanjali Yoga, for example, they say one method is to calm down the mind first. And so yogic methods are very helpful here. This Vedantic method is usually supported by yogic methods. You use the meditation, and if meditation seems dry, use prayer and devotion and bhakti. All of that is supported, used as support to calm down the mind. And in that calm mind, the difference between consciousness and the thoughts and consciousness becomes very obvious. And what happens at death? To put it very briefly, there's a whole theory for that. Basically, during, say at night when there is no moon, for example. So there is no moonlight. Look at that example. If the moon were not there, the earth also would not be illumined at night by moonlight, it would be dark. But does that mean sunlight is not there? Sunlight is there, but the moon is not there to reflect the sunlight upon the earth. The same way, consciousness exists. What happens at death is, according to Vedanta, the sukshma sharira, the mental body, the mind and pranas and intellect, they move away from the dead body and they go and take up another body. This is the theory. And because the subtle body, the mind and buddhi and prana, that is not there in the dead body, it cannot, like the moon, it cannot catch the reflection of, it cannot catch the light of consciousness and reflect it upon the body and the world. So, we feel there is no consciousness there. In the absence of a reflector, there is no reflected light. But the light is there. Just like in the absence of the hand there, you will not see the light reflected. Light is there. The hand is like the subtle body, the mind, which catches, or like the moon here, which catches the sunlight and shines it upon the earth as moonlight. The subtle body, mana, buddhi, ahankara and all this, at death leaves the dead body and goes to another body. Therefore, in the dead body, there is no sign of consciousness. There is no, apparently there is no consciousness. That's the answer. Should we wrap up now? I think we have run out of time. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Maharaj, for the wonderful talk. As I have said, it is not an overstatement to say that you are a tidal wave in a great ocean of Vedanta, and clearly we are drenched in its witness now. Now, I request Bharadwaj to deliver the vote of thanks.
We have come to the end of an enlightening session. On behalf of Vivekananda Study Circle, I extend my heartiest thanks to our speaker, Swami Sarvapriyananda ji, for taking us through a journey from the duality of known and unknown to the realm of the non-dual knowing unknown. We ever remain grateful to Swami Atmashraddhananda ji, who has been a source of continuous inspiration and guidance to all our activities. We thank Professor C. Balaji of Mechanical Department for taking personal interest in guiding us through all our activities. We extend our sincere thanks to the Director, Professor Bhaskar Ramamurthy, and the Dean of Students, Professor Shivakumar. We also thank the Placement Office for providing us the venue and the CLT staff for smooth conduction of the program. We are grateful to the CCE for the video coverage. Most of our previous lectures are on YouTube channel. You can always look at. Finally, I thank all the past and previous volunteers of Vivekananda Study Circle. The untiring selfless effort of the generations of volunteers over the past 18 years have been responsible in keeping up the good work. I thank all the faculty, staff, and students in the audience for making the program a success. Namaste.
We shall end this glorious evening with Shanti Mantra chanting by our volunteers.
Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.